Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Forgiveness, an Alternative Account by Matthew Ichihashi Potts. Narrated by Roman Howell. Introduction. On June 17, 2015, a 21-year-old white supremacist named Dylan Roof walked into historic Emmanuel African Methodist Episcopal Church in Charleston, South Carolina, and joined 13 others for the Wednesday evening Bible study. He sat next to the pastor, Clementa Pinckney, and listened for a while and then bickered with the group over their interpretation of Scripture. When the congregants bowed their heads and began to pray at the close of the study, Roof rose, withdrew a concealed handgun, and began murdering the people who had welcomed him into their spiritual home. He killed 9 members of the congregation and was quickly arrested. At his arraignment, several, but not all, of the victim's surviving family members offered forgiveness to Roof through a closed-circuit television feed to the jail where he had been remanded. "I forgive you," Nadine Collier, daughter of 70-year-old Ethel Lance, said through tears. "You took something very precious from me. I will never talk to her again. I will never, ever hold her again. But I forgive you." Bethane Middleton Brown, sister of the slain DePayne Middleton doctor, said to Roof, "I acknowledge that I am very angry, but we have no room for hating, so we have to forgive. I pray God on your soul." Wanda Simmons, the granddaughter of victim Daniel Simmons, also spoke directly to Roof, saying, "Although my grandfather and the other victims died at the hands of hate, this is proof. Everyone's plea for your soul is proof that they lived in love, and their legacies will live in love. So hate won't win." Observing these public acts of forgiveness during an interview, the writer Ta-Nehisi Coates wondered aloud, "Is that real? I question the realness of that." If forgiveness is real, then it's a real problem. Many philosophers, theologians, and scholars of religion have grown skeptical of forgiveness's value, its reality, or both. And they do so in part because of dramatic and unsettling examples like the previous one. Isn't it a moral hazard of some sort when a person who remains entirely unrepentant and absolutely allergic to reparations, who still menaces violence and still threatens victims, is offered forgiveness without any condition at all? Why is it so often people of color and people already marginalized by systemic violence upon whom this forgiving responsibility falls? What unjust purpose might the valorization of such suffering serve? Isn't the offer of forgiveness more of a salve to the conscience of power than an instrument of victims' healing? And isn't it a moral outrage to pressure victims into offering this forgiveness, to mandate that those already subject to loss and victimization assume responsibility for redeeming their offenders? Consider the words of the Reverend Anthony Thompson, surviving husband of the Reverend Myra Thompson, who offered forgiveness at Roof's arraignment, but also later said, "If they give Roof the death penalty, I'm not going to interfere. As far as I'm concerned, he doesn't exist anymore. This is gonna be with us for the rest of our life. But Dylan Roof has no place in that." Or consider the Reverend Waltrina Middleton, DePayne Middleton doctor's cousin, who wrote on the anniversary of the Charleston shooting in 2020 that, "To insist on a narrative of forgiveness is dehumanizing and violent, and it goes against the very nature of lament. As Christians, we celebrate the donning of ashes and sackcloth as a priestly act of lamentation and mourning. Why deny families, in this watershed moment of grief, this right to lament?" In this book, I both honor Waltrina Middleton's demanding question and reframe Ta-Nehisi Coates' skeptical one. I do so by beginning with these survivors' angry and grief-stricken words, while also attending to the forms of forgiveness they say they have offered. Forms that reject hate, but not anger, that deny superficial healing and forgetting, and that refuse unearned reconciliation. instead of the narrative of repair while Trina Middleton rightly recognizes as too easily imposed upon these statements of public grief, I explore the moral status and potential of Christian lament as itself a practice of forgiveness. I believe the Reverend Middleton is correct. Christian forgiveness does too often deny or diminish grief. I therefore want to ask what a Christian forgiveness that rooted itself in grief would look like, and reflect upon the implications for our moral theology. Having observed the lasting grief and anger of these forgiving families, instead of asking, "Is that forgiveness real?" I ask, "What if that were real forgiveness?" Forgiveness, as it is typically understood, definitionally, defies our ethical vocabulary and destabilizes our moral foundations. When a law or code demands some recompense for wrong, how can we at the same time obligate or encourage the setting aside of that recompense? Forgiveness resists rationalization, but the adequacy of our moral grammar does not exclusively condition the reality of all our moral acts. Like Theodore Adorno, I assume that moral questions arise only when our moral vocabularies and grammars begin to fail. To wonder about the problematic possibility of forgiveness at all is to presume some limits to our moral language, some gaps in our moral models. And so, I am wagering that an adequate depiction or description of forgiveness will depend upon limning these limits and minding these gaps, that it will require the exploration of unsettling examples. I suggest that any real forgiveness will and must challenge the assumptions and test the boundaries of our moral instincts themselves. In other words, I suggest in this book that what forgiveness actually reveals when it strains our moral sense is not its own unreality or impossibility, but the hidden limitations of our moral reasoning. In this book, then, and in the light of these troubling examples, I ask, what if forgiveness were real? What would a just and livable forgiveness look like? What if forgiveness allowed for anger and rage and grief? What if it preserved mistrust and could keep a safe distance for its victims? What if forgiveness acknowledged hurt rather than promising healing? What if it uniquely reckoned with the permanence of a wound, rather than hastily dressing that wound with a thin reconciliation? If forgiveness did these things, then how might we come to understand the forgiving words of Nadine Collier, Bethane Middleton Brown, Wanda Simmons, or Anthony Thompson, or even the searing lament of Waltrina Middleton? How might our moral grammar have to evolve in order to answer the question of forgiveness? How would our moral theology change as our grammars thus evolved? What is real forgiveness, really? And do the notions and habits that go by its name in our faith and our philosophy, the practices of pardon that have currency in our moral marketplace, really live up to forgiveness's most distressing and pressing demands? Many of the same worries and incoherencies discomfit Christian theology when it considers the forgiveness of God. The dominant theological model of God's forgiveness in the Christian West is one effectively interchangeable with the theology of atonement, and the contours of it are largely familiar to most Western Christians. Human beings owe God goodness or honor or holiness or all three, but having failed to live up to these virtues, so the story goes, they now owe God a debt of some kind. And punishment pays. Moreover, since the goodness for which humans were created is inseparably linked to their very existence as creations of the Father, that is, since we are finite and God is infinite, the punishment required by God's justice is as foundational to our being, and it is endless. We owe an infinite debt by virtue of our existence that we cannot ever pay. Our very being is an obligation. Having betrayed our being itself, how can we possibly be forgiven? The traditional solution to this problem of punishment is Jesus, the Son, himself God, and yet also the object of God's judgment, whose punishment can cover our infinite debt, and who, unlike us, may undergo this infinite punishment without it entirely exhausting his being, since he, like his Father, is infinite. It's simple bookkeeping, really. We owe God more than we can afford to pay. God, in Christ, shares our plight and then pays on our behalf. The accounts once again balanced, we are allowed to enter into our eternal rest. But if we have paid any attention at all, we should have noted on our way into paradise that the cost of settling our accounts has been an astonishing cruelty. The torture and execution of Jesus of Nazareth, the condemnation of a son by an unrelenting father, the self-immolation of a brutalized God, and the uncritical valorization of suffering for generations of Christ's disciples to come. God's forgiveness is anything but free on this account. It is paid for clearly and dearly in blood. For all the Christian talk about unconditional forgiveness, in this foundational example of divine forgiveness, God does not forgive for free. There are conditions, and there are costs to God's pardon, and they are steep. Even if we are relieved here of our anxieties about the moral hazard of unconditional forgiveness, we should be horrified by the cruelty of the conditions God has stipulated. Of course, this is not the only theological story we can tell about the death of Jesus. There are other interpretations of this sordid history, other accounts we can give of our hope in the cross. The outlines that have been carved into this atonement model are so familiar, we barely question their necessity, but there is no necessary interpretive frame for the cross of Christ. We may preach Jesus Christ and Him crucified, but that doesn't mean we always know what to say or what it means. The metaphor that traditionally grounds this theology is entirely economic, usually given in terms of debt, obligation, and repayment, or sometimes in terms of gift. We owe God goodness. We exist by God's unending gift. We are in God's debt. God demands payment. Jesus pays on our behalf through punishment. Sin is debt. Punishment pays. And forgiveness is the moral form of God's holy, balanced books. And indeed, the New Testament language around forgiveness, aphiemi in the Greek, remittere in the Latin, does connote the payment of a debt, an economic exchange that sets the price for a slave's freedom. The unforgiving slave in Matthew chapter 18 has his debts forgiven, and the simple analogy to sin in this parable is difficult to avoid. But aphiemi and remittere, the words translated as forgiveness from the Greek and Latin New Testament, concern not debt, but distance in their literal etymologies. Aphiemi means to send away. To remit, at its root, is to establish a distance. When authority to forgive sin is granted to Peter and the disciples, for example, the operative verb is luo, to set loose. So New Testament forgiveness is a slippery thing, to say the least. Its metaphorical sense is economic, but also spatial. In many cases, aphiemi appears to require some sort of repentance or implies a reconciliation. In other circumstances, it appears to require nothing at all. Often, forgiveness from God seems to depend upon forgiveness between humans. Judge not, lest ye be judged, we're told. But then, there is also Christ's prayer from the cross in which he asks God to offer forgiveness without condition. A prayer considerably complicated by the fact that Jesus' divinity entitles him to answer his own prayer. All of this is only to admit that aphiemi is used in the New Testament without a great deal of consistency, and that other verbs, like luo, in the sense of binding and loosing sin, also seem to carry some of modern forgiveness's semantic weight. I'm not particularly interested in extrapolating from Scripture a semantic consistency in the usage of these Greek words, though others have attempted something of that sort. As Mark Jordan notes, there can be no appeal to the simplicity of the Gospels. They are not a detailed moral code of any kind. They are contradictory stories studded with paradoxical aphorisms. Every theology that is not written as a life told four ways already departs from the most authoritative model of Christian writing. I therefore take the incoherencies and contradictions of scriptural forgiveness for granted. Instead of attempting to parse or coerce an impossible consistency, I attempt to read the story of divine forgiveness as it is told four and more ways in order to locate modern forgiveness within a broader theological and moral landscape. If I come to soften some of the sharp contradictions of the scriptural witness in so doing, it is ancillary to my goal of articulating what is finally and most importantly at stake in the modern concept. The governing analogy of sin in the Christian West is economic, and its roots do reach to the New Testament. But there are other ways to read amphiemi, and thus other ways we might interpret this tradition. Were we to think of sin not as debt to God, but as distance from God, and were we then to consider the mission of the Son sent away, amphiemi, by the Father to be the crossing of a distance, the opening of a loving space capacious enough to contain sin, if we thought of Christ's work as the journey into a far country rather than the payment of an awful price, we might find that the typically nifty logic of atonement, that the cost of sin must be paid in full and that only the God-man can pay it, falls away and is replaced by another, perhaps more lovingly tragic, far less cruelly heroic one. If sin is distance, then the Son's obedient estrangement from the Father is a journey already implicated in sin, a mission always and already also a remission. If sin is distance, then God's love will be signaled by the chasm Christ crosses to meet us rather than the torture he bears to win us. If sin is distance, then God's love reaches rather than redeems. If Christian forgiveness could set aside the moral accountancy that structures so much atonement theology, if the penal links of payment between God's love, Christ's suffering, and our sin might somehow be sundered in Christian thought, then the forms of Christian forgiveness that tend to follow human wrong might likewise become self-reflexively less cruel. Forgiveness would set a distance between ourselves and sin, perhaps even between ourselves and other sinners, rather than invite some redemptive suffering to reimburse it, or inflict some imprudent reconciliation to repair it. In the chapters that follow, I offer a modest theological defense of forgiveness, a defense because I insist that forgiveness is real and that it is worthwhile, modest because I concede that much of what passes for forgiveness in thought and custom should be largely set aside. Theological, because I set that all aside due to its complicity with what I see as a misguided theological tradition of interpreting Jesus of Nazareth's death. In other words, I do not just conjure a concept out of thin air. I aim to defend forgiveness by casting off much of what its name connotes while constructing an alternative from the neglected resources of theology. Part of my aim is to show that the intuitive associations among sin, punishment, and forgiveness that so thoroughly undergird our morals also largely pervade Christian doctrine, all the while obscuring other moral and theological possibilities. But when framed differently from the outset, it may be that they imply a radically different form of both divine and human forgiveness. Consider again the example with which I began, Nadine Collier's insistence that she will never stop missing her mother and so never forget this loss, Bethane Middleton Brown's persistent anger alongside her determination to forgive, Anthony Thompson's absolute refusal even to acknowledge Dylan Roof's existence. In these examples, wrongdoing cannot be compensated. Reconciliation remains impossible, and wounds will never fully heal. Indeed, forgiveness here seems little more than the refusal of retaliatory violence. It is about forswearing vengeance and rejecting retribution. It is about accepting that what has been lost cannot be regained. As such, it demands no condition and neither assumes nor expects, let alone aspires toward, any reconciliation. It is, despite the conventional wisdom, more broken-hearted than whole-hearted, full of rage as often as repaired. Forgiveness of this sort is more tragedy than triumph, less miracle than mourning. It is a strategy for surviving an irrevocable wrong. It declines to escrow the life of the future to a past that cannot be changed, or to a pain that cannot be compensated. I suspect that what makes unconditional forgiveness incredible, literally unbelievable, in examples like the ones that trouble Coates from earlier, is that forgiveness typically comes to us with such hollow confidence. Too often, forgiveness callowly promises the impossible in the wake of horrible injustice, right when we are most unready to recognize redemption. Just when we are least persuaded by the possibility of miracle. I therefore suggest that the typically triumphalistic tone of our usual language around forgiveness is itself a part of the problem, and that, in fact, forgiveness trucks in much messier and more miserable stuff, as Collier, Middleton Brown, Simmons, and Thompson know all too well. Forgiveness is difficult and trying and painful and unending. But it can be real, perhaps, and holy sometimes, too. To elaborate a bit, allow me to suggest the following. First, forgiveness is not about feelings. We should feel restored or at peace when we forgive, we are told. We believe that when we forgive, we should have moved on, or at least should have put aside our wrath and our resentment. Indeed, for some, a primary purpose of forgiveness is its use as a tool for self-transformation, so that one can allow oneself to move away from damaging or negative emotions, such as rage and rancor in the aftermath of wrong. Recently, psychological literature has complicated this picture, distinguishing, for example, the decision to forgive, which wills a behavioral change or commitment, from emotional forgiveness, which signals a change of heart or affect. But I argue that forgiveness has no necessary relation to positive affective change. If forgiveness is simply about what one does, or rather about what one restrains oneself from doing, then one's feelings needn't enter into it at all. On the contrary, the emotions that follow trauma are always volatile, and often remain so for long periods of time. Restraint from revenge likely will mean struggling with bitterness and anger. Emotions are always fleeting. One cannot expect victims of injustice or trauma to feel permanent equanimity after a single momentous decision to forgive. Instead, one should expect that victims and survivors will feel all sorts of emotions in the wake of their trauma, whatever their decisions about forgiveness. Rather than a determination never again to feel rancor or resentment in perpetuity, forgiveness is simply a promise not to act with retaliatory violence when those painful emotions and vengeful desires inevitably and repeatedly arise. What matters with respect to forgiveness is not how I feel about the person who has wronged me, but how I measure and temper my interpersonal response to that wrong. Second, and relatedly, forgiveness is not reconciliation. We presume that forgiveness requires welcoming an offender back with open arms, with restored relation between two parties, even if only momentarily. Indeed, we often use the language of forgiveness and reconciliation interchangeably, but restored relation is, strictly speaking, the work of reconciliation, a work I characterize as crucially distinct from forgiveness. This is for practical as well as theological reasons. Reconciliation can be a good and honorable goal, but it may demand certain concessions or actions between parties that my version of forgiveness, restraint from revenge, need not. conditions can and should of course be met before a perpetrator and victim establish, transform, or restore their relationship. At minimum, the safety of all concerned should be assured. But if all forgiveness demands is the forswearing of vengeance, then it need not carry any specific conditions, not even these basic ones. To be sure, there is a voluminous commentary in both philosophy and theology about the necessity of various conditions, if any, required for a felicitous offer of forgiveness. But I find that these mostly depend upon a collapsing of the distinction between reconciliation and forgiveness. Forgiveness may in some cases prove a first step to reconciliation, or it may simply occasion a lasting non-retaliatory estrangement. Some may object that a restraint which lacks the desire to reconcile wants the moral bravado of self-sacrifice, so often canonized in Christian thought and practice. But we should be wary of such valorizations and their manipulations by power, I think, for moral and theological reasons. Christians are commanded to forgive, it is true. But it's also clear that full and final reconciliation is ultimately the eschatological work of God in Christ. Colossians chapter 1, verse 20. When bodies and lives are at risk, it seems to me mere restraint is quite saintly enough. We will love our enemies as much as we can with our broken human hearts, but that may not be much, perhaps just enough to keep us at a safe distance. God can love our enemies and us the rest of the way to reconciliation, if and as God so chooses. In fact, there may be a commendable spiritual humility in declining to collapse forgiveness into reconciliation, because restraint from violence while full and final reconciliation is left to the eschaton can theologically signal the limits of one's own love while recognizing the infinite reach of God's. God loves those we do not or cannot love. And so we intend God's children no harm. We refuse to exact vengeance, even when they deserve it, even when we might wish it upon them, for God's sake. And then we keep our peace as we wait for God's infinite love to bridge the painful chasm sin has opened in our lives. It seems to me that the additional step of requiring fully achieved human reconciliation, that is, fully restored relationship, as opposed to a cautious and estranged non-retaliation that need neither strive nor even hope for reconciliation in this life, misreads the theological tradition in significant ways, and with troubling moral consequences. It replaces Christ's work with our own. Earthly reconciliation beckons intimacy, right or wrong, and in this fallen creation, it is often obviously wrong, or at least carries unjust dangers and demands. Forgiveness, as I describe it, meanwhile, can turn its cheek while also keeping a safe distance as it does. Third, forgiveness happens in time. This is obvious, perhaps. What act does not occur in time? What I mean to emphasize here is that forgiveness not only obeys those laws of irrevocability and irreversibility that the physical passage of time imposes upon us, but that forgiveness is furthermore an act expressly responsive and suited to these chronological constraints. That is, forgiveness rejects retaliation precisely because of the futility of vengeance with respect to the irrevocability of time. Much of the popular and scholarly discourse around forgiveness implies that it can either undo, restore, or erase the past. But the common delusion that an act in the present can somehow rectify a wronged past is in fact the hallmark of retribution's magical thinking, not of forgiveness's realist grief. It is part of why the language of moral debt is so ill-suited to sin and forgiveness. If you take $5 from me, you can give $5 back, with interest even, depending how we define repayment. But if you kill my brother, no act can restore what has been lost. This restorative penal fantasy and retributive punishment's constant conceptual linkage to forgiveness skews our moral reflections upon these issues. I seek to sever this linkage and suggest that whereas punishment too often attempts vainly to will backward in time, forgiveness should in fact seek to do exactly the opposite, to be available to a difficult future. Forgiveness reckons unflinchingly with a past that cannot be undone. The futility of retribution's urge to turn time backwards is precisely what forgiveness understands and works against. This, then, is why throughout this book I characterize forgiveness as akin to mourning. Forgiveness seeks to live in the wake of loss. It accepts that what has been lost cannot be restored, and then it aims to live in and with the irrevocability of wrong. If forgiveness is a moral good, then it is good only in the sense that mourning might be construed a social or psychological good, not because mourning itself is a wonderful and enjoyable thing, but because it is the way we learn to struggle with and through and in a loss we cannot redeem. On this account, once again, forgiveness is more tragedy than triumph, less miracle than mourning, more resignation than redemption. And in this sense, forgiveness's theological provenance becomes clarified too, as it is, I think, better understood as a habit of Christian non-retaliation than as the spiritual regulation of post-traumatic emotion or as the coerced companion to an injudicious reconciliation. Christian forgiveness, as certain corners of the theological tradition will evince, is thus an expression of love for one's enemies, though, when understood in this way, it may also transform our expectations of what Christian love requires. Forgiveness is the habit of non-retaliation, or better, it is the judgment non-retaliation renders. We cannot forgive virtues. We forgive only sins. But as it issues its condemnation of sin, as it resolutely names a violation that cannot be undone, forgiveness also accepts that past as unalterable and so imagines what possibilities for the future its battered history might bear. If forgiveness is more mourning than miracle, a manner of living with, rather than magically fixing a broken past, then its posture is paradoxically forward-facing. Since forgiveness addresses the past so unflinchingly, it also necessarily and paradoxically sets itself honestly toward whatever future can actually come to be in the wake of that past. In attempting to find the past's wrongs livable, even if irrevocable, forgiveness requires and inspires imagination. To refuse the retributive attempt to undo the past is to accept that past and to be open to the only possible future that can follow from it. The urge to live with loss is still an urge to live, and so forgiveness will be, even if only reluctantly, a stance of openness toward the future. It is a future some parts of which we may dread, a future which might demand that we daily face down sorrow, anger, and anguish. But just as the realism of mourning involves an acceptance of a future bereft of one's beloved, forgiveness's refusal to forget its wrong imagines what a wronged life lived well might be. It does not vainly try by violence to restore a life that has been permanently destroyed. It refrains from a retaliatory attempt to rectify an irrevocable wrong. It looks with grief toward what life really must become going forward, and then it faces that future with a grim will and survives. It is precisely because forgiveness refuses the retributive fallacy of fixing the past that it is freed to move. Slowly, painfully, and even perhaps like Christ, with permanently open wounds, into the future. This is a book of theology, but it is also a book of literary interpretation. Another way of saying this is that I am writing theology in the margins of literary texts. In some sense, of course, theological writing has always been marginal. theology has always operated as a commentary upon scriptural and other authoritative, ecclesial, liturgical, devotional, historical writings. But from those margins, theology has aimed to give life to these writings, to unearth their subtleties and relevance to readers' lives. This book aims to perform the same normative theological writing in the margins mostly of literary, but also of theological and philosophical works, to unearth their subtleties and relevance to readers. And even if these works themselves make no obviously dogmatic or explicitly theological claims, I will. I want to be clear, however, this is not a work of literary history or of literary criticism in the usual sense. I am not interested here to give an exhaustive account of how forgiveness has been articulated across time in a particular literary culture or by a single major writer. Several works of this type already exist, some of them quite excellent and important. Although I depend upon and note others' critical scholarship where necessary, neither is my aim to review the readings of others or to discern how a particular set of literary texts regards forgiveness. Rather, I use these texts to make my own argument about how Christians in particular ought to do so. I expect this approach may discomfort both some literary critics and some theologians, but I'm convinced that my readings and my strategy here are methodologically sound and uniquely appropriate to this project. To do this, I undertake in this book extended readings and analyses of a novel by each of four contemporary writers: Kazuo Ishiguro's The Buried Giant, Marilynne Robinson's Gilead, Louise Erdrich's La Rose, and Toni Morrison's Beloved. Of course, forgiveness is a common problem in human life, and a frequent topic of literature across time and place. One might reasonably ask why I chose these particular authors to aid in my argument, or why these four of their many novels. To answer the first question, it is clear to me that these authors have persistently engaged with a wide range of moral issues deeply related to forgiveness throughout their work. Ishiguro has explored questions of memory, apology, and remorse in all of his books. Robinson's early first-person novels invite useful reflection upon confession, while her later novels give way to the complications of love and reconciliation. Erdrich's recent work especially has unsettlingly rendered dilemmas of revenge, justice, and atonement. And healing from the violence of the past while making a way into the present is a constant concern across Morrison's fiction. But it's not just that these four writers often focus on forgiveness. Other authors obviously do so too. I have selected these four in particular because I believe their literary explorations complicate the problem of forgiveness in exactly the way I think Christian theology has often failed to, but manifestly ought to. Ishiguro's early novels, set as they are in Nagasaki, not only examine issues of apology and remorse, they also raise questions about guilt, blame, and the annihilating consequence of modern war. These themes resonate throughout his work and should inform any adequate theological account of forgiveness. Robinson reflects upon our relation to past wrongdoing in all of her novels. But situating interpersonal and familial forgiveness within the context of 19th century American abolitionism and 20th century American racism, as she does in the Gilead books, reveals how the interpersonal and familial can obscure broader political concerns about justice and obligation. A theology of forgiveness that hopes to address both the political and the interpersonal should do likewise. In her Justice trilogy of The Plague of Doves, The Roundhouse, and La Rose, Erdrich repeatedly explores issues of revenge, community, redemption, and atonement. But in setting these explorations under the colonial conditions of contemporary Ojibwe life, her novels unsettle European moral assumptions in a way that a Christian theology of forgiveness eager critically to engage white supremacy, including its own, must welcome. And though Morrison's works do often depict habits of personal and social healing among Black communities in the United States, the forthrightness and candor with which she documents the scale of their violations prevent any forgiveness she suggests from appearing to be an easy remedy or a simple solution. A theology that hopes to offer forgiveness as an answer must also ask the most difficult questions, and Morrison's novels always do. Why then these four novels? In truth, the answer is partly personal. They are my favorites. I find each quite difficult and beautiful and moving, and it has been easy to spend many hours of study and reflection in their company. My reasons are also practical. For the sake of my writing and your understanding, four novels is enough. But the main and most important reason is more substantive. I have selected these four books by these four essential writers because each story is singularly preoccupied not only with forgiveness, but also with grief. The Buried Giant is about war and retaliation and punishment, but it's also about an old couple mourning the death of their son while coming to grips with a terminal illness. Gilead is about abolition and racism and the return of a prodigal son, but it's also about the complications of dying while trying to love the dead. La Rose is about building community under colonial conditions and about what repair remains possible beneath the weight of a genocidal history. But it's also about two families reckoning with the death of a young child. And while Beloved is about living both with and beyond the burden of memory and the traumas of horrific violence, it's also about being haunted by loss and living with unending grief. As I have said before, I believe forgiveness can be usefully framed as a habit of grief and a practice of mourning. And indeed, I believe framing forgiveness this way might transform not only our understanding of it as a Christian practice, but also our approach to Christian morals more generally. These novels, insofar as they begin and end in grief, thus provide ample and inviting margins in which to write this moral theology. Part of what I argue in this book is that the effort to live loss into the future, to wrestle a habitable life from the anguish of our grief, will usually involve some engagement with language and will always oblige imagination. Indeed, I suggest that to engage loss with the language at all, even despairingly, even if all we can bring ourselves to say is that there is nothing whatever to be said, is to attempt to place our faith in the possibility of meaningful relation mediated through fallible words in the aftermath of harm. Why cry out that we have no words unless we wish our wordlessness to be heard by others? Language may only frailly or imperfectly facilitate meaningful relation, but even when, especially when, it is self-conscious of its limits, all its fragile failure can still mediate relation and signal an embarkation upon the future. This is how I read the New Testament writings compiled and shared in the aftermath of Jesus of Nazareth's death. His friends and students, traumatized by his death and haunted by his resurrection, took up the types and tropes of their time and place and essayed to imagine a future without their friend and teacher. But just as the survivors of his death used the tools and frames at hand in their time and place, the religious culture of ancient Judea and the traditions of Hellenistic philosophy and the oppression of Roman authority to read and write the meaning of Jesus' life and death into cross and communion, into ministry and mission, I also see those who continue to mourn Jesus' death today as engaged in a similar struggle. That is, to mourn Jesus in at least one sense is to seek some habitable meaning for and from his death in our own world. This is not necessarily to undermine those Christians who would set their firm faith in Christ's resurrection against my exhortation toward mourning. It is only to suggest that the aim of understanding how the crucified one still lives in our own lives is an urge largely congruent with the movements of everyday mourning and grief, even if we believe the circumstances in Christ's case to be supremely and supernaturally unique. Modern Christians may also be traumatized by Jesus' death and haunted by his resurrection. And while it's true that Scripture bears a unique authority for us modern-day mourners, just like those ancient saints before us, we take up the language of our time and place, with all our own types and tropes, our own habits and traditions and privileges and oppressions and scriptures, and attempt then to read and write the meanings of this death into our lives. This is and always has been the method of theology. None of this is to deny that early Christian scriptural writing is still quite different from contemporary fiction, or that the biblical witness can and should carry unique authority for Christian theologians. But the manner of doing theology is the same, whatever margins we write that theology in. We have a loss and the story of a loss, and a given language by which to note our meanings in the margins of that story. Whether in the 1st or 21st century, we have the death of Jesus and the call to discipleship, and a world around us through which and of which to make these redemptions and demands more livable. To put this all more simply and more to the point of this book, I do not find that the theology of the Christian West historically and in general has always grappled convincingly with the problems of forgiveness. Mostly because those problems are linked to deeper confusions I see in the theology of atonement already internal to Western Christendom. But contemporary literature wrestles with forgiveness most admirably in a way that mimics Scripture's similar complexities. Literary fiction, and these fictions in particular, allows forgiveness to be a problem. It is unsurprised by how forgiveness confounds and confuses. It doesn't aim to clean up the mess forgiveness leaves. Literary fiction doesn't expect to speak conclusively of forgiveness. It only wishes to speak at all. It looks for, but does not ever conclusively find, meaning in its fraught scenes of forgiveness. And in so doing, it in fact mimes the meaningful movements of forgiveness itself, which is also provisional and fragile, a habit of continued survival rather than a conclusive feat of sanguine understanding or triumphant resolution. Of course, this is the nature of literary language. It succeeds insofar as it opens rather than closes meanings, insofar as it speaks of something inexpressible, and in so doing, allows that much more still needs to be said. Indeed, it is because literary language only provisionally asserts its significance, because it knows it is frail and fragile and still cannot but speak, because it knows it must fall short in crucial ways, because even, or especially, the Bible will remain open to interpretation and available for misuse and misunderstanding, that I attempt to include the literary in my theology. Literary writing is writing that has become a question, writing that self-consciously recognizes its own provisionality and frailty, even as it steps into the void and makes its semantic stand. It is writing which knows that it cannot ever say quite enough, but resolves to speak meaningfully anyway. One might be tempted here to say that this provisional frailty is also one foundational to Christian theology's understanding of itself and of its own object, of the Word made flesh who is given to us in unstable signs, in word and sacrament. The fragile movement of mourning into provisional meaning that is exemplified by the New Testament writing is also one that literary writing embraces and the incarnation perhaps establishes. That Christological claim can be argued more fully elsewhere, but at this point at least, in apology of this theology written here from the margins of literature, let me finally simply say, it is because contemporary literary fiction so frequently and so beautifully presents the problem of forgiveness, and because Christian moral and systemic theology so often fails to, that literature offers a unique opportunity for a theologian like me to critique and reconstruct Christian forgiveness on more careful, subtle, tentative, in other words, on forgiveness's own, terms. As it is to most people, forgiveness is personally important to me. The desire to forgive and to be forgiven has arisen in all of my significant relationships. Since we cannot forgive without implying something about the nature of justice, it may be that every personal forgiveness is political too. so the politics of forgiveness is also deeply personal for me. Issues of war, peace, wrong, and repentance have structured my family history and my identity in essential ways. My father is white from the United States, and my mother is Japanese. My grandfathers served on opposing sides of a war in which Japan committed horrendous atrocities throughout Asia, in which U.S. aerial bombardment targeted Japanese civilian non-combatants with fire and atomic bombs, and in which the U.S. government employed racist policies to authorize the internment of its citizens and the seizure of their property. After its surrender and under the supervision of Allied occupation forces, Japan renounced war and committed never again to establish armed forces in its 1947 constitution. Since then, Japan has wrestled with recognizing and apologizing for its war crimes. The United States, meanwhile, has also struggled to reckon with the impact of its atomic bombings, though it has paid reparations to survivors of internment since the late 1980s. My father met my mother in Japan while serving in the Navy during the United States' own misguided incursions into Southeast Asia, and while stationed at a naval base meant to provide Japan the defense it could not constitutionally provide itself. I also served in the U.S. Navy, at that same naval station, on a ship already notorious for having killed 290 innocent people in 1988 because of a mistaken missile strike on a commercial airline. I eventually departed naval service as a conscientious objector. I am a Christian who aims to take with absolute seriousness Jesus' instructions to repent and forgive and love my enemies. But taking these commandments seriously means acknowledging the staggering challenge of their demands. It means grappling with what they could possibly mean under the complicated and conflicted conditions of our world. Conditions of racism, colonialism, war, and atrocity. The conditions out of which my family has somehow managed to arise, even while so many others have perished. It means wrestling with the reality of loss and the possibility of life beyond it. This book is one attempt to do that. The first part of this book takes up the question of accountability, and the second part of atonement. The first part asks the question, if we forgive a wrong or wrongdoer, how can we hold that wrongdoer accountable to their wrong? In Chapter 1, I consider how the inclination toward retaliation, the compensation of harm throughout proportional punishment, is institutionalized in law, and how these legal models and the forms of extra-legal forgiveness they imply depend upon a problematically violent model of sovereignty. Through readings of Kazuo Ishiguro's novel The Buried Giant and analyses of Friedrich Nietzsche, Vladimir Jankélévitch, Jacques Derrida, and Hannah Arendt, I articulate a form of forgiveness that rejects compensatory schemes of justice and instead attempts freely to initiate the risks of a new future while remaining knowingly beholden to the wounds of its past. In Chapter 2, I turn toward issues of repentance and confession, meditating upon the compensatory logic of customary forgiveness through readings of Michel Foucault and Martha Nussbaum, showing how confessional sincerity and narrative accountability function as currencies for transactional models of punishment and forgiveness. Following Judith Butler, I articulate a form of narrative accountability that is grounded on the impossibility of full self-articulation rather than on its necessity. From this critique, I turn to Marilynne Robinson's novel Gilead in order to explore the threat that an ethic of explanatory self-justification poses for theology. In further readings of Judith Butler on the use of violence and explorations of both Dietrich Bonhoeffer and the Japanese philosopher Tanabe Hajime around issues of guilt and justification, I offer a reading of Robinson's novel that exposes the profound moral and racist failures of its central characters, and propose a model of forgiveness as a twofold commitment to both persistent penitence and retaliatory restraint. In the second part, I focus more explicitly on the implications of these questions for Christian theologies of atonement and vice versa. Informed by traditional atonement models that emphasize God's anger, in Chapter 3, I first explore the effective dimensions of forgiveness and uncover in both the 18th century Bishop Joseph Butler and the contemporary philosopher Charles Griswold a conceptual tie between our preoccupation with anger appeasement and the sovereign exceptionality of forgiveness. I link this preoccupation to the fragile anxieties of white supremacy and then turn to Louise Erdrich's novel La Rose in order to develop a different theological posture toward anger in atonement from the colonial setting of an Ojibwe reservation in North Dakota. Using the theological analyses of Paul Fedez and John Milbank, with attention to the atoning work of love in the theology of Julian of Norwich and others, and keen to incorporate indigenous perspectives on relation and kinship, I discern in the novel a love that self-consciously exceeds the bounds of the personal and necessarily invites politically significant relationship. A love that forestalls any too easy reconciliation for the sake of honoring both history and victims' anger. In other words, I reveal a love that can bear rather than bury, endure rather than erase human sin. In Chapter 4, I continue exploring what it would mean for love to bear and endure our deeply broken histories rather than to bury and erase them. To do so, I consider Jeffrey Blestein, Paul Ricker, and Miroslav Volf on the role of forgetting in forgiveness. I critique the inclination I see in much Western thought to impose an unearned resolution or even a happy ending upon our histories, a resolution intended primarily to assuage or curtail the pain and anger of our grief. In a reading of Toni Morrison's novel Beloved, I explored the dangers of this unearned resolution and questioned the degree to which conventional Christian understandings of resurrection might be held in sway to them. Turning to Rowan Williams, Michel Desserteau, and M. Sean Copeland, I suggest a theology of resurrection that unrelentingly insists upon the reality of loss. And then I explore how writing and imagination can emerge into the space of that loss. Following Julia Kristeva and Jacques Derrida, I suggest a mourning that insists on speaking of the past irrecuperable losses while simultaneously insisting on the absolute inadequacy of our speech. Forgiveness as mourning thus emerges at the end of this book as a persistent practice of writing, speech, and critique.
Part 1. Accountability. Chapter 1. Retaliation. How should we respond to wrongdoing? Whatever else forgiveness may be, it is a way we address and reckon with past wrongs. Our attitude toward forgiveness will therefore depend at least in part upon how we think about the past and upon how we think about wrongdoing. Much of what follows in this book approaches these difficult realities, the past and its brokenness, from multiple literary and theological angles. In this first chapter, I draw the possibilities of forgiveness into greater relief by considering another way of responding to wrongdoing, retaliation. I argue that retaliation may be understood as forgiveness's opposite, that in fact forgiveness might usefully be defined as the commitment to forego retaliation. But our retaliatory impulses run deep, both conceptually and culturally. It may be that forgiveness only ever makes any sense if we are willing to abandon not just the right of retaliation, but also the logic that underlies that right. Forgiveness could help us reconceive our forms of justice away from any fantasies of recompense. Retaliation moves within a matrix of related words and meanings. In our common speech, it seems more well-reasoned than revenge, but less controlled than retribution. If I seek vengeance, I act with abandon. If I seek retribution, I move with calculation. When I retaliate, I do something of both. I lash out, but in a measured way. Etymologically, retaliation is fundamentally rooted in the idea of careful proportion. The English word retaliation traces its roots to the lex talionis, the law of talion, or literally, the law of like for like, rooted in Exodus and Leviticus, and more remotely related to Hammurabi's code. Retaliation assumes a justice meted out as an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. The proper way to respond to a wrong, retaliatory logic suggests, is to respond in kind. There is virtue in this logic, because a law of like for like presumes a condition of equal status and equal regard. The rich man's eye is worth no more or less than the poor man's, and so a like for like compensation can inscribe this equality into law and upon bodies. Of course, even in this law, there are limits to equality of status and regard, since in Exodus and Leviticus, not to mention in the laws of Babylonian and Roman analogues, these protections were in place only for men and only for men within specified social categories. Nonetheless, we can understand how we might read the law of like for like as fundamentally concerned with equity and justice. Over time, Jewish scholars and teachers interpreted this law away from literal mortification so that my neighbor's loss could be calibrated to a standard financial compensation. Thus, I might pay a fee rather than lose my tooth. This presumption of compensatory damage deeply structures our moral instincts and expectations. We believe crime demands punishment, and I argue that our assumptions about forgiveness are constrained by this retaliatory frame. We tend to think about what wrongdoing and wrongdoers owe. We perceive moral failures as debts, and when we do, we come to think less clearly about what forgiveness is and does. In this chapter and the ones that follow, I argue that in fact forgiveness posits a different sort of response to wrongdoing, one that questions the prudence of returning past pain in kind. Forgiveness turns away from retaliation, not only because it rejects the satisfaction of its own understandable desire for vengeance, but also because it denies the possibility of eradicating its own pain. The loss it has suffered is so grave and irredeemable that it can only accept the ineradicability of its loss while turning away from any customary or compensatory satisfactions. In this chapter, I pay close attention to our ethical urge toward retaliation, toward the law of dealing like for like, toward trading suffering for suffering and paying for pain in pain. To do so, I explore the novel The Buried Giant by Kazuo Ishiguro and its depictions of remembrance and revenge, as well as introduce considerations from a range of thinkers on retaliation and its relation to the law. I suggest that a clear-eyed approach to irrevocable wrong might help expose the potential moral misreadings of the lex talionis, while coaxing us not only toward a more useful form of forgiveness, but also toward a more challenging model of justice. Satisfying justice. Kazuo Ishiguro's novel, The Buried Giant, appeared in 2015 as something of a departure from his other work. Ishiguro's novels tend to share a patient, reflective pace and a disposition toward loneliness and loss, even if they do exhibit a consistent willingness to pursue new forms, mix genres, and explore unfamiliar literary territories. Though Ishiguro's early novels resemble each other narratively, since The Remains of the Day, they have seemed self-consciously to differ from one another in important formal, if not thematic, ways. The Arthurian fantasy underlying The Buried Giant marks the largest such departure in his body of work. Ishiguro sets his novels mostly in the present or near-present, even if these worlds are sometimes dystopically or psychologically refracted in disarming ways. But the buried giant is set in a linguistically stylized and self-consciously fabular Britain at some time during the settlement and conquest of the Saxons, when the memory of Arthur remains fresh among the people and his knights still patrol the land. The novel flirts with the genre conventions of fantasy, and indeed it received some awards for fantasy fiction. But it was also poorly received by some readers who thought it employed the conventions of fantasy and allegory awkwardly. My own sense is that the novel is both beautiful and important, and if the Arthurian allegory provokes discomfort, it is mostly for the difficult questions it raises. The novel's plot is fairly straightforward, if shrouded deliberately in a fog of mystery. The story opens with an elderly couple, Axel and Beatrice, living in a warren of dirt hovels among a community of Britons. We are given the sense that the two are somehow marginal to the community. They are treated with dismissiveness and disdain, but they understand neither the reason for their marginalization nor the general aggression and unkindness that surrounds them, and this is largely because almost nothing among the Britons can be remembered. Axel and Beatrice cannot recall conversations or the previous day's events. Children go missing from the warren, but searches for them disband in confusion after a few hours. The emotions around minor arguments remain, even if the claims and contents of those arguments are lost. Beatrice comments to her husband that the forgetting is like a sickness that pervades the whole land, an amnesiac plague afflicting all the people of Britain. But even this lament over lost memory is fleeting. Mostly, we're told, it simply doesn't occur to these oblivious villagers to think about the past. Axel and Beatrice share some unstated, unremembered, and nonetheless obvious sense of loss and sadness. Beatrice surmises that a visit to their son's village will relieve this sadness, and although Axel opposes this journey for some time, he cannot remember why. The novel opens with Axel relenting to Beatrice's wishes, and they finally leave the cruel exclusions of their warren to embark upon a journey across open country to a village whose name and location they cannot recall. We soon discover that this affliction of forgetting affects not only Axel and Beatrice and their community, but all the people of the land. Beatrice suffers from an undiagnosed pain in her side, so she and Axel start their journey by visiting a nearby Saxon village to seek advice from the Briton healer Ivor, who lives as an alien there. There is a constant threat of violence as they travel. The Saxons are on edge because of a nearby ogre attack, for example. But this nervousness also manifests as mutual suspicion between Britons and Saxons, and an aggressive tension among peoples. Forgetting makes people uneasy and suspicious of strangers. Ivor hides Axel and Beatrice upon their arrival at the Saxon village to guard their safety amidst the village's suspicion and disorder. While lamenting and reflecting upon the forgetfulness that has descended on their land and peoples, Ivor recounts to Axel and Beatrice the visit of a stranger the previous year who had speculated that the pandemic of forgetting might also afflict the divine, that perhaps God's own mind might no longer have access to the past, and a past eradicated from the mind of God would have no chance of memory in the minds of mortals. But Beatrice recoils at this idea, finding it inconsistent with God's love. "Can such a thing be possible?" she asks Ivor. "If God loves each of us dearly as his own child, could God really forget what we have done and what's happened to us?" Beatrice worries that God's love must keep its memory for it to be infinitely loving, a concern to which we shall return later on. But after they have left the village and Beatrice has had more time to reflect upon the affliction of their forgetfulness, she wonders in a quiet moment with Axel whether God might indeed choose to forget their pasts. If God were sufficiently angry or ashamed, she speculates, then perhaps a divine forgetting would be necessary in order to eradicate those effects and accommodate God's love. Axel's response, however, is curious. Even if God's anger were so substantial, Axel wonders, why doesn't God punish us and satisfy that wrath, rather than consign the world to foolishness and confusion? At first, with Ivor, Beatrice refuses to believe a loving God could forget. But when she considers the anger or shame memory might occasion, she thinks again. Axel here reacts differently. If God's memory gives rise to anger or shame, then God would or should most reasonably expiate that divine effect through punishment. And indeed, that expiating punishment would serve as a mnemonic function for the sinning people as well, as opposed to letting them forget like fools. Axel suggests that punishment would be preferable to forgetting, and indeed might serve as an aid or instrument of memory. All of this introduces a dilemma central to the plot of The Buried Giant: the relationship between love and memory. Because on their journey to their son's village, Axel and Beatrice become concerned that they will not be able to remain together unless they can somehow prove their love through a shared memory of their past, a proof I further reflect upon shortly. Ivor recommends that Beatrice travel to a nearby British monastery for further examination of her ailment, and for their protection, he sends the elderly couple on their way with an itinerant Saxon warrior named Whiston, who slew the attacking ogres and rescued from them a Saxon child named Edwin. The travelers are soon also met on their way by an aged Sir Gawain, who roams the land hunting the dreaded dragon Curig. Gawain accompanies the small band to the monastery. Upon meeting Gawain, the Saxon Whiston asks the Arthurian knight how Arthur managed to heal the deep wounds of war between Britons and Saxons so quickly and with barely a trace of conflict remaining. The answer we find is that the dragon Curig's breath is enchanted with amnesia, that the mist Curig exhales shrouds both the land in fog and the minds of the people in forgetting. Curig's breath quells memory, and with it the anger that might give rise to violence. What gradually emerges from the novel's fog of forgetting is that the dragon's breath is the historical work of King Arthur and his knights. Mired in a forgotten war between Britons and Saxons, caught in an escalating cycle of reciprocal violence, Arthur could see no escape from Saxon retaliation and no avenue for future peace other than through a wholesale forgetting and occlusion of the past. But his technologies of forgetting are sometimes cruel and sometimes conjured. He partners with Merlin to trap Curig and enchant her breath with amnesia. But he also commands the massacre of children so they will not grow to remember and avenge their fathers. We eventually learn also that Gawain is not Curig's hunter, but her guardian, and that his mission since the days of Arthur's reign has been to protect the land's pacific amnesia from Saxon avengers like Whiston, who might seek to lift the mist and uncover the truth of their past sufferings, thus stirring anger and a cycle of retaliation once again. This leads to a final confrontation between Whiston and Gawain late in the novel, during which moral questions of vengeance and punishment arise in much the way they did between Axel and Beatrice. Facing one another with swords drawn before Curig's lair, Whiston and Gawain wax theological, speculating upon God's opinion of the land's forgetting. Against Whiston's accusations of forgetting as sinful, Gawain protests that whatever God's disappointments, Arthur finally brought peace to the land, and therefore Whiston's and Gawain's gods alike should bless the enchanted dragon for ending the intractable war. But in an echo of Axel's earlier pondering of divine punishment, Whiston protests, asking, "What kind of God is it, sir, wishes wrongs to go forgotten and unpunished?" Punishment is here once again associated with memory, perhaps even collapsed into it, so that retribution might be seen as mnemonic, itself as a moral practice of memory. Gawain persists in pleading for patience, arguing that a year or two more of the forgetting fog may prove sufficient an amnesiac erasure to guarantee lasting peace. But Whiston remains unconvinced by Gawain's pragmatism and asks the old knight how a wound infested with maggots could ever heal, or a peace built upon slaughter could ever hold. Whiston also notes how Gawain's pragmatic peace cynically obscures his own complicity in sin while undergirding British power. Gawain and Arthur's pious devotion to peace cannot be separated from their avoidance of any responsibility for the violence Keurig's magic quells. The past is covered, but not erased, Whiston argues, and it demands a just remembering, a form of memory that arises uniquely as retaliatory punishment. Vengeance to be relished. This association of memory with punishment is not novel to this fictional depiction of late ancient Britain. It is deeply rooted in our moral instincts. In On the Genealogy of Morals, Friedrich Nietzsche excavates the roots of our moral intuitions when he asserts that if something is to stay in the memory, it must be burned in. Only that which never ceases to hurt stays in the memory. Pain is mnemonic, Nietzsche argues, and because of this, it naturally incorporates into human systems of power, religion, and conflict. According to Nietzsche, humans could never do without blood, torture, and sacrifices, and religious rites of obligation and mortification in particular, when attempting to establish ineradicable memories, since pain is the most powerful aid to mnemonics. But this recourse to pain for Nietzsche all begins in the human capacity to make promises. Because humans are will-driven creatures, they intend and sometimes are able to effect a future, and they articulate their plans for that intended promise among others. But because the future is uncertain, some of their promises will fail, and pain, on Nietzsche's account, becomes a tool of promissory enforcement.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.